so many people deal with anxiety and depression and in so many different ways on so many different levels. So lots of times you'll hear about it or know someone's dealing with it, but there's not like that particular connection. I think whenever anybody can find that in any sort of mental illness, it's comforting, you know?
I'm Lily Cornell Silver, and welcome to Mind Wide Open, my mental health focused interview series. Today, I am talking to the frontwoman of Bully, Alicia Bognanno, who is a singer-songwriter and guitarist. She just released her most recent album called Sugar Egg, in which she talks a lot about her experiences having bipolar 2 disorder. So she's going to talk about that today, what that experience looks like for her, and how it relates to her music. Thank you so much for watching, and I hope you enjoy.
Hi, Alicia.
Hi.
Thank you so much for being here.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
So you just released your newest album, Sugar Egg, under Bully, but it's a solo project. Mm-hmm. And it features a lot of references to your recent diagnosis of bipolar 2 disorder. Mm-hmm. What inspired you to be so open about being bipolar, even while you're still kind of navigating like what that looks like for you?
I mean, I was hesitant to talk about it, but you get pushed so much for like bio stuff. And in the past, well, I try and be as best I can be about only talking about things that I'm comfortable talking about and I won't have to second guess later. But it was such a big part of my life. I didn't know how I was going to get around talking about it.
Wow. Okay.
Because it just totally consumed me for the past, you know, 4 years and everything.
Totally.
Kind of revolved around that. I hate to say that because, you know, I'm not my diagnosis. I don't want to let it have ownership over me, but it just felt like it was unavoidable to talk about if I was going to talk about the music.
Sure.
I was kind of like, well, I've kept it like a secret for no reason. And I just felt okay with it. I think I felt like I had more of a grasp on it and not like I wanted to like joke about it or anything, but I wasn't as paranoid about being judged or having a stigma around it. And honestly, if someone wants to, then I don't really care. I don't really need them in my life anyway. But right.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it just kind of got to the point where I was like, okay, I need to talk about this because there's just no point in hiding it. And I don't want to like, you know, have this record be the next 3 years of my life and not be able to talk about the main part.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. When did you get diagnosed?
About 4 years ago.
Okay. Okay. Mm-hmm. So was there like a turning point where you were like, oh, this is something that like needs to be diagnosed? Or what did that look like for you?
Yeah, I just got to the point where it was really debilitating. It was particularly for work because I just, the social media aspect of it made me sick. I couldn't post anything without feeling like I was going to throw up. I would be like up at night worrying about it. Mm-hmm. I was so paranoid. I was starting to like turn down shows because I had this fear that I was going to be like booed off stage or something, which has never happened. And I was really convinced that a lot of the people around me who loved me and were trying to help me had like ulterior motives. It was just like in the back of my head, I was like, oh, well, why do they want me to do that? Because of this, because of this. And it's like, no, because I care about you and I want what's best for your career.
Right.
I had to go in cause I was just so paranoid. I couldn't really exist.
Wow. Okay. That's super interesting. I have a friend who, has pretty severe bipolar and that's like one of the main things that he struggles with is like feeling like his parents are like plotting against him or like out to get him in some way. And that's an aspect of the experience that he talks about a lot. And in that vein, like I know, you know, I have several friends and family members who have bipolar and it looks so completely different for all of them. Like it's such a broad spectrum. And I think that's something about bipolar that people really don't understand. Like there's kind of one like media idea of what bipolar is, but like it's, you know, it's so diverse and can look so different. So what does it look like for you and like a day-to-day thing? Like what is your experience?
Two parts of it that still are frustrating to me is even though I've spent so much time understanding and familiarizing myself with the cycles, I still sometimes don't know until it's like a little too late, or I'll have had a week where I'm just like, oh, I feel so good. Like, I'm just so happy. I'm so like, I'm going to rearrange my house. And like, I just want to be super active and like, I'll do whatever on social media. And then like 3 days after that, I'll start to get really heavy. And it gets kind of discouraging to think back and be like, how did I not know this was coming? Like, how could I not tell? Another thing is just, I mean, besides obviously I take medications every day for it, but is I have to do so much to just keep my head on straight, like to just stay level. I have to very actively exercise. If I don't exercise, I feel like a ball. Like I can just feel irritation coming off of me. And I just need to put everything down and be like, the other day it was like I hadn't for a few days and I was just so, I just felt awful and so upset. And I just stopped working. And I was like, I need to just go on a run. There's nothing else I can do right now except for run. So it's keeping up with that. And meditation, which I don't do as much as I should do daily. Honestly, you hear about it all the time, but when you actually do it and practice it, it is life-changing.
It's one of those things that everyone I talk to about meditation goes, I should do it more than I do.
Yes. Yeah. Every time I make myself do it, I get done. I'm like, this is the best I felt all week.
Wow.
It's just like so important to kind of keep in mind that the world is so much bigger than you think. And it's easy to manifest on very small things that essentially don't matter. And that is pretty much how I keep, I would say like, or try and keep myself in check. Whenever I'm stressing out about like, oh, someone said this or someone said that, I'm like, well, I'm going to die one day and I should enjoy my life.
Like, right. Yeah. No, meditation definitely has that kind of grounding and like zoom out effect for me, that like not, you know, not sweating the small stuff and being able to be more in the present moment.
Totally. Do you meditate daily?
I should meditate more than I do. Yeah. I have like, you know, there's apps like Headspace and like things like that that I use. But something that I've been reading a lot about is like different forms of meditation, like that so many different things can be forms of meditation, like writing and playing music can be a form of meditation, like painting, walking outside, swimming, like those can all be forms of meditation.
Yeah. I mean, playing music is the most therapeutic thing in the world, like by far. Playing a show is like 45 minutes where you just forgot about anything that was bothering you, or you figured out a way to funnel it into the show. And it's just like, unlike any other feeling in the world.
With struggling with bipolar, did that aid your music process or did it make it harder to like motivate and harder to write? Cause I know when I'm struggling with my mental health, like sometimes it can be a good creative motivator, and other times it can just be like, I just can't, like, I can't do this right now.
Yeah, I would say it definitely aids it. And I hate to say that in a way, because I don't like it how mental illnesses can be romanticized, especially in rock music. I think that's treading very dangerous waters, and I wish that wasn't a thing. But I tend to write when something is bothering me or upsetting me. And that is not to say I can't write a good song when I'm happy, but when I'm there, it helps me get through it.
Totally.
And absolutely, playing live is like, if something happens to me that day or week or month or year and I can play live, it's like the best way for me to just let go and let all my energy out. That's actually something I really struggled with during quarantine, because because you don't have that outlet anymore. Yeah. So it's like, you know, figuring out what else you can do, but you really learn to appreciate that when it's taken away.
Definitely. And just for my own knowledge and for people who might not know that much about like what bipolar looks like, what's the difference between bipolar 1 and bipolar 2?
The main thing is bipolar 1, you have had an episode where your mania gets so high, you're like hospitalized, and it can shift to a higher place. Bipolar 2 is usually the depressive place is longer. It's like switching places of awful moods, pretty much.
How was it like suddenly being very, very vulnerable about it? Like, was the response good or was it tough?
It felt so good.
Oh, good.
I mean, that was like the first time a lot of my cousins and family and anybody, like friends, heard about it. And it just felt like good to have it out there. It was just like, I don't need to hold on to this anymore. This doesn't need to be like a dark secret that I'm afraid I'm going to be judged by. I was just like, this is out. And it was, I think, the best way to kind of share that information, because I didn't have to have those, like, those one-on-ones.
Right.
When I think about talking to about it to people, first of all, I don't want any sympathy.
Right.
Like, I'm like, don't ever want to be like, woe is me, which isn't, I think when you get to tell someone about it, it's just a weird thing because you don't really have the right words to describe how you feel or what's going on in your brain. And it's just like a very lonely place to be. And you just kind of think, well, even if I tell them, they're not going to feel how I'm feeling. You know, what are they going to do with that information? If it's someone you love and care about you, hopefully they'll read about it and research it and try and help you with it. But if somebody's just, you know, not that interested, you tell them and then nothing has changed really. So it's a very strange one-on-one conversation to have with somebody, you know, because more than often, they're not going to know how to respond to it.
Right.
And it's kind of hard to sit with that.
Definitely. And that's something with, you know, with this series and in my own like day-to-day life, wanting to spread as many resources as possible and like kind of create a different situation where people have more vocabulary to talk about things like that and more information so that those conversations can be had and that it's not kind of this weird, like, you know, in my case, like talking about losing loved ones to suicide or like struggling with PTSD and anxiety and depression. Like you know, try to just have a conversation, the same thing. Like I'm not looking for sympathy. I'm just wanting to have a conversation about my day-to-day life and people just have no idea how to respond.
Yeah.
So that vocabulary is super important.
Yeah. Yeah. And I also think that like, it's okay to like deal with your shit and feel your feelings and want help getting through that. There is nothing wrong with that.
When you have had conversations about it with other people that have been helpful, like what do those look like to you? Like what does a helpful conversation look like or a positive conversation?
A really cool conversation I had, well, with my therapist, maybe that doesn't count, but
that definitely counts.
Okay. Well, she's usually the most helpful conversations. She has pointed out so many times, I'll be like, oh my God, like the medication saved me. I'm so happy for the medication. She'll point out, she'll be like, yeah, it helped. But also you've done a lot of that work and you need to like take credit for that. And you know what I'm saying? Don't.
Totally.
So I don't know. That was just cool to hear. But I actually like to talk to people about it and how they're like with other people who have it, because I just don't get to have that conversation very much. Like I was listening to a podcast the other day. I forget what it's called. It's like Stuff You Should Know or something. And they had an episode on it and hearing them discuss it, I was like, yep, yep, yep. And it just is like, it's nice. It's like
super validating.
It's super validating. Like oddly, it's really validating because you're like, hey, this isn't in my head. I'm not alone. Like it's just, you know, I don't know, that connection that's hard to find.
And speaks to the importance of talking about things openly, you know, in like whatever format, like that podcast or this series or just amongst friends, like speaks to the importance of creating that validation for other people by just having destigmatized normal conversations about it as you would physical health.
Totally, for sure. It's just, yeah, it's important to be talked about. And I think, like, you and I discussed this on the phone the other day, like, so many people deal with anxiety and depression and in so many different ways on so many different levels. So lots of times you'll hear about it or know someone's dealing with it, but there's not, like, that particular connection. I think whenever anybody can find that in any sort of mental illness, it's comforting, you know?
Totally. Your new record, Sugar Egg, which I love.
Thanks.
So good. So what songs, were there particular songs you can point to that were written specifically like about your struggles with mental health?
Yeah. Come Down and Like Fire and Prism.
Yeah.
Yeah. I would say those three are like the most... when I wrote Come Down and Like Fire, I just was in a horrible place. And it was, absolutely a way to be like, let's just get through this.
Sure.
Like Fire is just about like the drastic changes and like mm-hmm. ups and downs and like right. how it feels when I'm there. And it's funny because people have asked about my faith or like asked sure. if I was religious because God sure. is mentioned, and it's totally nothing against anyone who's religious. I'm not religious personally. It's more of an idea of somebody always being there and everything's going to turn out okay. And everything happens right. for a reason. And then you get to that place mentally and you feel so alone and you're like, no one is here right now. Why is this happening? This could not be, nobody should be in this place. This is not yeah. meant to be. I don't wish yeah. this on anybody, but it's really about just like, I mean, that song is very literal to like states of mind that I have been in 100%. It's weird. It's weird writing about it in songs because you write about it and you're like, no one's going to know what I'm talking about. Like, peel my skin off. What is this? And then I'm like, whatever. I'm going to write it for me. Who cares?
Totally. And which is like, in my opinion, wholeheartedly what music should be, is mm-hmm. doing for yourself. And if other people can relate to it or find, you know, whatever meaning in it, that's awesome. But
yeah.
Not necessarily the goal all the time.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wanted to talk to you a little bit too about your experience with audio engineering as a woman, mm-hmm. like a male dominated field. And I read in your New York Times article, like struggling with mental health in high school or like just growing up, and how audio engineering felt like, you know, kind of a reprieve from that.
Yeah. It just, well, I mean, in college it was pretty uncomfortable just because I was a lot of times the only woman in all my classes, and I just felt right. a lot of pressure. Like, I can't fuck this up because then I'm going to give women a bad rep, which is so dumb. My last year in it, I just opted to do my studio projects alone because I was like, I'm not going to be in a position with some dude who's going to try and take the reins. And, right. and I'm a very physical learner. Like, nothing makes sense to me unless I am doing it. Like, you could tell me all day, but until I'm actually doing it, I just, my brain is like in a million different ways. So I just was like, I'm going to do this alone because I'm never going to learn if I'm going to be, you know,
yeah,
treated like I'm going to be put on the back burner naturally. Mm-hmm. Right. Growing up, I was still trying. I wanted to be, I felt like I was my grades. Like, that was mm-hmm. like how I felt mm-hmm. growing up. You're validated is like, you're smart, or if you don't get good grades, then you're dumb and you have no future. Our public school could take electives from the art school, and you could drive over there and they had a audio engineering class. But I mean, it was super rudimentary. It was like the bare base. I mean, you were like, oh, that's a microphone. Like, oh, I talk into it. I wasn't like, how does this compressor work?
Right.
I did that class, all A's, and kind of, I think I maybe like applied to a college or two and like didn't get in and didn't really have a lot of plans for it because my grades were so bad. And MTSU, which has a bachelor's of science in audio engineering, like pretty much anyone can get in. It has like a 47% graduation rate. It's like not a great school, but the program is really cool. And so I was like, okay, I can get in. Right. It's like not like Belmont school prices or anything. It's like commuter college school. I started studying and started playing music with people and was surrounded by people who wanted to like be in bands and
yeah.
stuff. And that's how it all ended up, was like that teacher. And I think about that teacher all the time because I'm just like, I don't know what I would have done.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, teachers are so amazing. Yeah.
Do you feel like taking that class at the time helped with your mental health?
A little bit. I think I didn't really have much of a grasp of what was going on. I remember I would be like buttering a bagel in my kitchen and just start crying and just be like, what? I don't know what's happening. But I don't know, like, when my bipolar came on. I mean, I always remember having anxiety and like depression growing up.
Right.
It would take me like 3 hours to fall asleep. And I just thought that's what it was. I thought that was normal until I got to college and was like, maybe because I was drinking or maybe because I was so tired that I fell asleep for like the first time very quickly. And I was like, oh, it doesn't take people 3 hours to fall asleep. I'm pretty sure I had anxiety then and I didn't know what it was.
Right. So completely. No. And that seems to be a pretty universal experience. In one of the recent episodes I did was like a panel of my friends and like peers talking about mental health and their journeys from like childhood to now. And almost all of them said like, yeah, I definitely had very severe anxiety or depression as a kid and had no idea.
Yeah.
Like, no, that's what it was. Thought that I was either thought that it was normal or like thought that they were crazy because they didn't, you know, there were no conversations being had around like
And I think it's like easily written off like, oh, you're just an unruly teenager. And that's what teenagers do. And there's already that like gap in communication between you and your parents at that time. Right. Anyway, probably because teenagers are such a pain in the ass. Mental health is wild.
It is. And it's a constant thing. Like it's something you have to be for me. Like I'm having to check in on myself constantly throughout the day.
You really do.
Yeah. Just to like make sure everything stays.
Am I here?
Exactly. Does your self-care routine change depending on like kind of what stage of like the bipolar cycle that you're in?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. Because when I get like, when I get really down, I still don't really get out of it very well. It's just hard to find any motivation. It's hard to do anything, really. It's like everything is a chore. But I'll try to get up and like run, but I would say I'm more likely to make myself do that when I'm more in an irritable state or like a frustrated state. So I'm like going, but I'm just very irritated. And then when I feel good, I'm like, where's the pizza? Give me the ice cream. I don't care. I'm not going to think about myself or have paranoia about my body, whatever sort of like garbage you find yourself thinking about. And then I'll like work out too on top of that, but it's not like as much of like, this is all I can do. But I mean, when I'm down, I try and do that, but it's more of a lot, you know, Dharma talk meditation time.
Right.
And then sometimes you just have to lay in bed for a day.
Right.
It's just like, the irritated, frustrated points, I have to work out. And even aside from just being bipolar, if you're working a lot, you're communicating a lot, you're emailing a lot, whatever, you just got to like get outside. I've found that getting outside is so important. Like, especially if you work from home, which everyone is doing right now. Mm-hmm. And I've only realized in like the past few months, like don't work over the weekend. Like, because it's so easy to do. I've been like trying to find weird stuff or like, is there a cave I can go visit? Or there's like this park in Louisville that has these massive troll statues that I can go drive to, or a hike. And it's just so important to when the weekend comes or whenever your weekend is or whatever you decide your day off is, to like get outside and just see something else and think about something else and learn about something else. And that has been huge for me during quarantine. Mm-hmm. Also with everything that's been going on, this is going to sound so corny, but for a month and a half, it was like, I forgot that there was any beauty in the world because I was just consuming.
No, so true.
Consuming the news. It was, it's arguing, it's anger, it's COVID. It's just, everything is just like,
so intense.
Horrible things going on, like just horrible police shootings that have always happened. You know what I'm saying? It's just, and just like the COVID updates every day that I was reading, and I don't know. I just like, there was a while where it was all that I knew, and I got to a point where I was like, okay. Before I was like, all right, I'm sick of checking. When I pick up my phone, I'm waiting in line or something, opening up Instagram. I'm not going to do that anymore. I'm going to got the New York Times app. started doing that. And I was like, all right, I can't do that with the news anymore. So right. I just like sat down one day and was like Googling positive news websites right. to like keep on my head, like My Modern Met or something where I would go to right. and just see cool, creative shit that like people are still building in this awful, dark time, you know, that you don't think about.
Right.
And totally. Just remember that there are things out there that we haven't ruined yet.
right.
And I think being able to get out of my house and go, you know, going and seeing other things or other forms of art or just like nature, it is very reassuring and just like gives you a little bit of motivation back and makes you feel less discouraged for sure.
I have a question that's like more for me.
Yeah.
but just curious, like,
I mean, you can ask a lot about you. Give me a break.
But I was just curious, like curious to hear from you in my experience with like struggling with mental health issues, like in being in relationship, like especially like romantic relationship with somebody, what I found is there can be a lot of frustration from like a partner wanting to fix you and like not like there's frustration when they can't make that happen. And there's like yeah. a lot of misconception around like mental health issues aren't things that need to be eradicated or like erased. Like you're not healed once it's erased. Like yeah. it's like you accumulate tools to learn how to integrate them into your day-to-day life. Yeah. So I'm just curious if you've had like struggles with that, like in romantic relationships, trying to, you know, like heal and help yourself and then also like be with somebody else.
Yeah, I think about that a lot because I just have a hard time in romantic relationships always. I feel like I shouldn't say this about myself, and it's not true, but I often feel like I am just like hell to date. Like, I just feel like a weight. I just feel like a
burden feeling. Yeah.
A burden. I feel like a burden. And I literally said this to my partner the other night. I was just like, I just feel like such a burden because... And a lot of times too, it's just like, I'm so impulsive. I can't sit with, I need to talk. Like if something is going on that I thought was like a weird look or something, right. it's like, are you okay with this? It's like, I need to talk about it. I feel like it consumes my body thinking that maybe something's wrong or like you're upset. It's just like every little, I can't put anything aside. And it's one of my worst qualities. But yeah, I feel like that my mental health ruins. It doesn't ruin, but it makes it very hard for me to be in relationships because mm-hmm. when you just know you feel like shit, you don't want to put that, not put it, but, and this isn't the case because they want to be there for you, but you just right. feel like you don't want to be a constantly right. toxic person in their, right. in their life. And it's just yeah. like, yeah, you just feel like a burden. And I have a really hard time with that. Like, right now in the middle of that, it's just the worst feeling in the world. And then it just makes you mad at yourself. Like you're just like, why am I doing this? Why do I have to be this way? Just like be chill, you know, like just be cool. Like just be cool for like one day. Like, right. could you just right. not for a day? Like just don't. I cannot believe the patience that my partner and anyone that I've ever dated has had. I can't believe it. It's just, and I think that's their form of helping me deal with it, you know, like maybe they identify it and they know that. And so they make a note to be patient about it and to not react in a way that would only fuel the fire. Right. But no, that is a huge thing. As far as fixing it goes, I haven't had that happen. I haven't had anyone try and fix me. I think I might be like, yeah, please fix me. But no, you're right. It's like, I've also never dated anybody who is like, I don't know what's mental health. You know, it's like everybody that I've dated, I feel like is either dealing with their own shit or pretty aware of it. Yeah. And so I think that they're sensitive to that, but how have you how do you think about that?
I feel like more like I've had a lot of experiences with people who are like you know, like, that don't really understand. Like I had someone ask me one time, like a boyfriend was like, what's anxiety? I was like,
yeah, you're like, your brain's just like, oh.
Like, can we please switch lives?
I know.
It's been interesting and it's been kind of a hard road to walk in terms of like when, because I, you know, struggle with PTSD and then anxiety and depression, and like knowing that it's an explanation but not an excuse, you know, like yeah. I'm able to vocalize like I'm really, really anxious right now, or I'm struggling with this, but it's not an excuse to be really shitty, you know, yeah. to out on your partner. So
totally.
That's
totally
like,
learning to vocalize it is right. a process. It is a right. thing that you need to do. Because instead, I used to just I would just kind of disappear for a few days. I would just be like, I cannot be around anybody and not be a burden. And I'm not comfortable telling you what is going on in my brain. So I'm just going to like act like I want to do my thing or whatever.
Right.
But you're totally right. It's like, you can explain it, but you, yeah, to not use it as an excuse. And it's a slippery slope because sometimes you want to just use it as an excuse. You're just like, oh, I'm sorry, I'm an asshole, but.
Right. Right.
I don't feel good.
Right. Definitely.
I feel like my like cycling of moods, I'm not usually an asshole. It's more so just like paranoia and whatever, just overthinking everything. It's just exhausting.
Right.
You know, when you're a kid, like when I used to go out to eat when I was really young, or even if like a Jewel song played on the radio, I'd be like crying in the back of the car as like a 7-year-old. But whenever I would go out to like, say I was like 7 and at Applebee's, if I saw an older person eating alone, I would just start crying. And like that person probably wants to be alone for all I know. But like in my head, I like make all these situations. This is so literal. But I'm not even joking. This is a real thing. Yeah. I ordered food from like whatever, Postmates or some mm-hmm. food ordering delivery thing. Mm-hmm. And this woman dropped it off and she was like maybe, I don't know, 65 or 70. She handed me my food and my brain was instantly just like, and for all I know, she could want to work. Like that's what she wants to do with her free time. That's probably what I'll do. But I was just like in my brain, I was just like, it's like, it's so unfair. Like you should not have to just like work forever. You know what I'm saying? Like you can't get a break. Like,
right.
I just wanted like her to feel good. And I don't know. So I like tipped her a bunch of money and then I shut the door and I was just like bawling. And I'm like, why am I even crying? Like she could be really happy right now. But just like the idea of somebody feeling insecure or like embarrassed when they shouldn't be, it's just, hold on. The idea of anybody feeling shame makes me really sad because I think that just I've felt so much shame and it's just the worst feeling, and so many times it just like shouldn't be there. It's like came from something that you don't even know, and I hate seeing people who look like they're feeling shame. It absolutely breaks me. It's just like I can't handle it.
Empath vibes. Empath. I definitely will have a similar I have similar stuff.
Empathetic to a fault.
Right. Completely. Where like suddenly I'll be feeling someone else's emotions and like start crying or something and they'll be looking at me like,
yeah.
You're like, I'm good. Are you good?
Yeah. Yeah.
Why are you crying on my behalf?
Being overly sensitive is like a blessing and a curse.
Definitely. Definitely. What is something that's giving you hope right now?
Going outside. For sure. And let me kind of like what I touched on before, just looking for things, people who are making cool art that like has nothing to do with what's going on right now, or that does, but can give you a break.
Sure.
Every kind of animal and watching any sort of animal documentaries, I love. They give me a lot of hope. There was this one I watched the other week that I Googled inspiring documentaries to try and get in a better mood. And there's this one about this 16-year-old girl who sails the world by herself for 2 years. And just, it's so cool. And little things like that, that you have to kind of sort out and you watch and you're like, wow, this is so amazing. And then you're like, I'm a failure, but it's like very cool. But little things like that give me hope. There's probably a better, easier answer that I could have said, but I can't think of it.
No, that's perfect. That's perfect. No, that's authentic and amazing. Well, thank you so much for being here, Alicia.
Thank you so much.
And for your openness and, you know, infusing mental health into art and music is something that's like one of my number one passions. So
it's so cool you're doing this. I love this. We need people like you in the world for sure.
Thanks.